are the great and mighty God. You are Yahweh, the one that we worship, the one that we adore. Oh, our God, you have decreed and we declare that this is Bethel, the house of God. This is where Jacob's ladder dwells. So earth to heaven and heaven to earth, earth to heaven and heaven to earth, dimension into dimension, dimension into a dimension, we come into alignment with you. Earthly saints, heavenly saints, angelic ones, the host of the Lord of hosts come together to worship you, to adore you, O great and mighty God, you who speaks and the earth rolls. Lord, we just worship you and honor you. All blessing and honor and glory and power belong to you and to you alone. Lord, you have said that eye has not seen and ear hath not heard what the Lord has prepared for those who love him. We cannot imagine, we cannot even come to close to imagining how great you are, how glorious you are. But Lord, we set ourselves into agreement with you that whatever you have planned for us, Lord, we step into it with every essence of our being. Whatever that you wish for us, whatever you desire for us, whatever you choose for us, Lord, we dive into it with everything that is within us. May it envelop us. May it enclose us in your love and in your care. Lord, we just stand before you, open and vulnerable before you. And we say, Lord, we trust you. We trust you. We trust you. And we honor you and worship you. Lord, we set ourselves now to worship you with everything that is within us. We worship you and we come into agreement, for this is now your glorious unfolding, and we worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We worship you.
Take a rest from the fight and don't try to figure it out. Just listen to what I'm whispering to your heart. 'Cause I know this is not anything like you thought the story of your life was gonna be. And it feels like the end has started closing in on you, but it's just not true. There's so much of this story that's still yet to unfold. And this is going to be a glorious unfolding. Just you wait and see, and you will be amazed. You've just got to believe the story. For this world and your heart has been to show his glory and his grace, forever revealing the depth and the beauty of his unfailing love. And the story has only begun, and this is going to be the glory. Remember, this life we're living is just the beginning.
my God. For you are great, so very great. You are clothed with honor and majesty, and you walk on the wings of the wind, and you wrap yourself in light. You just look at the earth and make the earth shake. And when you touch the hills, they burst into flame. Sing to the Lord as long as I live. I sing praise to my God while I have any being. And I give glory, glory, I give glory to the glory. Honor and majesty, and you walk on the wings of the wind, and you wrap yourself in light. You just look at the earth and make the earth shake. And when you touch the hills, they burst into flame. Sing to the Lord as long as I live. Oh, I sing praise to my God while I have any being. I give glory, glory, I give glory
my voice sing your praise. And I will give you honor, the honor that you do. I lift my hands to bless you. shine to the ends of the earth, the ends of the earth, and your glory is shining above the heavens. And your glory is shining to the ends of the earth, the ends of the earth.
magnify you, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Shandes,
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within us. Lord, we bless your name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless your holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless your holy name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. Where God's glory is all of his goodness. All of his goodness. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. How great is your goodness, which you have laid up for those who fear you, which you have prepared for those who trust in you. In the presence of the sons of men, you will hide them in the secret place of your presence. I just feel like that's where we're at right now, in the secret place of his presence. And I'm seeing what the Lord wants to do right now. See, I'm of the mind that God has a purpose and a plan every minute of every day. I have a mind that we have the mind of Christ, and if we're tapping into his mind, then we're all in the same mind and same accord. And that we're not here arbitrarily, and we're not here just to go through the motions. If God's not here, I don't care. I don't want to be here. And if we're just doing to be doing, I don't care. I don't want to be here. But if we're here to tap into God's glory and his presence, then I'll be here 24/7. I don't think things doesn't matter to God. I think every little thing matters to him. We just have to get into his mind. Before, you know, I was studying out these verses, and we might get to, I don't know what the Lord's going to do tonight, and I don't, you know, I'm just going with the flow, to be really honest. But I was studying out what I thought we're going to go, and right before I closed my Bible to say, it's finished, I'm good, the verse kept going over and over in my mind, in all you're getting, get understanding. And it's in Proverbs 4, and he's talking about wisdom. And, you know, wisdom is one of my best friends, and I love wisdom. But right in the middle of getting wisdom, in all you're getting, get understanding. And we can have all the wisdom, and we can be tapped into wisdom, but if we don't have the understanding to know what to do with the wisdom once we have it, it's worth nothing. And we have to understand, we have to get into that understanding. We have to tap into that and hold understanding in as high as esteem as wisdom. Now you have the seven spirits of God, you got wisdom and understanding. All of them are, all seven are, there's no higher, lower, it's all same plane. We always tend to focus on wisdom, but every one of them are of equal importance. And then he showed me, and I hadn't thought about these verses in a long time, but in Psalms 32, in verse 8, it says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. This says, be not like the horse or the mule, which lacks understanding, which must have their mouths held firm with a bit and bridle, or else they will not come to you. You know, you think about the Lord's given us free will. He's given us Holy Spirit so we can come alongside Holy Spirit. We can come alongside wisdom. We can come alongside Sophia. But then he says, come alongside understanding also. He says, don't be like the horse or the mule. You know, you heard about being stubborn as a mule. I mean, they have to put a bridle in that mule's mouth and then force it, sometimes with a stick over the nose, to make it do what it needs to do. And the Lord's saying, we don't need to be that way. We don't need to be held tight by a bridle to go hither and yon and to be turned by force. We're supposed to be so caught up in the flow that we just go with him, that we just flow with him. It says, don't be like the horse, the mule, which lacks understanding. If we lack understanding, we think that the Lord is going to turn us this way and turn us that way, and we'll just go where he turns us. But instead of stepping inside of him and going with the river of life and flowing with him. And he says, I, the Lord, God himself will instruct us, and he will teach us the way we need to go. But once he teaches us, once he instructs us and gives us that wisdom, then we need to grasp understanding to do what he's told us to do. And then he says, I will counsel you with my eye. So it means, you know, it's like when we have kids and they're young, we spend a lot of time teaching them. You don't go in the street. You don't go. This is why you don't go in the street. You know, you look both ways before you go in the street. You know, all that. And then they get to a point where before they go in the street, they look and you just give them that eye and they know whether to go or not. Are we to that point with the Lord where he can just glance at us and we know what to do? And we're paying attention. We're having our eyes on his eyes to know which way. Or are we just going to say, well, he has a bridle. Lord, put the bridle in my mouth and jerk me. Show me which way I need to go. I'm just a mule or I'm just a horse. It says, we are not to be that way, which lacks understanding. I was listening to Bill Johnson. In fact, this morning I was listening to him, and I thought it was really interesting. He said, there is no act of obedience that is powerless. You know, when a horse, when you're turning them, you don't think of that as being obedient. You think of them, well, they're just following what we're doing. But have you, you know, Steve and I, we watched Heartland a lot. And we watched how she trained the horses. And there was times when, you know, she would train them to a point, and then she would be able to take the bridle off and they would dance with her. And they would go with them. You know, you didn't have to have that bridle on. You know, have we been to that point? But it wasn't at that point, it wasn't so much that making them do it, it was that act of, they want to flow. They want to be in obedience. Are we that way? Because there's no act of obedience is powerful or powerless. It's powerless, is without power. It says every act of obedience of a believer releases presence and power. You know, we want to have God's presence, but what brings his presence is obedience. What brings that power is obedience. And then, you know, and what spirit of life about the presence and glory, right? And he said, and glory is manifested in the act of obedience. So the act of obedience of the believer brings his presence and glory, presence and power, but then the glory is manifested through that act of obedience. And it's an act of obedience that's not forced, but out of pure love. And I thought about, you know, in 1 Samuel, we all know, to obey is better than sacrifice, to hearken than the fat of rams. I'll go over there. And this is definitely not my main sermon, but here we go. Okay, 1 Samuel 15, that's where it's found. We all know the story. Samuel, the prophet, told the king instructions, and Saul got tired of waiting. And he obeyed to the point. He obeyed to a point, and then he took it to his own hands. And then Samuel said, has the Lord great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices? This is verse 22. As in obeying the word of the voice of the Lord. Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams. And I started thinking about, we always hear that obey is better than sacrifice, which means it's better to do what the Lord wants than to give our all. You know, it's like going back to the horses. You know, they're sacrificing their mouth to go this way or that, but to obey is just better. I would much rather my children obey me because they want to and because they love me rather than because I'm forcing them to. You know, when they're younger today, I mean, they're bigger than I am, so can't do much forcing, but except play the mom card. But even that's because they love me. They don't have to because they're bigger than me. But it's because they love me and they respect me. And it's the same way with the Lord. Are we doing it because we feel like we have to or because we love him? And it's better to obey him because we love him rather than, yes, I'm doing it because I have to. Yeah. Okay? But we all know that story. We all know that part. But what I thought was interesting is when, and I hadn't really thought about it before, I guess, or in a long time, but it says to hearken. Hearken is what? To listen. Not just to hear, but to listen. And hearken than the fat of rams. And the fat of rams was the sacrifice of the peace offering. And the peace offering is the fellowship offering. It is an offering freely given. And they came in and they all the priest took was the choice fat and burnt that. And the actual meat they would set in the temple and eat. And depending on why the peace offering was given, whether it was just Thanksgiving, they had to eat it that day. If it was because of a vow, they had 2 days to eat it. But what was offered on the altar was the ram, the fat part. And it says, and Leviticus 3 talks all about it, but Leviticus 3, if I can turn over there, I guess I don't need that. In verse 16, it even talks that the priest will burn them on the altar, an offering made by fire for sweet aroma. You know, we say, Lord, we want our praise to be sweet aroma before you. It's that peace offering. It's that fellowship offering. It's to be close to you. So the Lord is saying, you know, I want you to pay attention to me and listen to me even more than I want you to be in my presence. Even more than I want fellowship with you, I want you to listen to me and pay attention. You know, how many times do we think, oh, I just need to lay before the Lord. We just need to get in our secret place. We just need that fellowship time with God, which we do. I'm not negating that. I'm not knocking that. But if we spend all of our time in our secret place, how are we going to minister to those who are outside the secret place? You know, if we spend all of our time just fellowshipping with the Lord, which is awesome and wonderful, and we are taught there's no higher worship. But the Lord said, it's better for you to listen to me than for you to be in my presence. And we never think about that part. We think, yeah, we're going to obey, but God wants sacrifice. He wants the sacrifice of our praise. He wants the sacrifice of this or that. But he says, I want you to listen to me. And when you listen to me, you'll have the understanding to know what you need to do. There's a time for us to be quiet and in fellowship with him. There's a time for that peace offering. There's a time for that fellowship. And there's a time, even when you're in fellowship, how often, and I've done this before, more than once, I'm in the presence of the Lord, and I'm just worshiping. And I'm just, you know, in the heavenlies, watching what's going on in the heavens, and just having a good time and just, oh, in ecstasy, right? And the Lord's saying something. No, Lord, can I just stay here? Like, I need you to, can't I just stay here? This is better than there. This is better. And he's like, it's better for you to listen to me than for you to be in my presence. And I thought about that. I was like, you know, we're asking for God's presence. We're asking for his glory. We have to have his power before we can do anything. But to do that, we have to have obedience and we have to listen. And truly, truly listen, because anything else is just going through the motions. And you've heard me say a lot of times, and I'm very serious about it, I'm done doing the motions. We still fall in that rut. It's easy to fall into that rut. But that's not what God wants. It's better to do what he wants than even to get into worship, the true high worship. Better to listen. Better to obey. And sometimes that's a hard thing to understand. But God has so much for us. We can't even comprehend what the Lord has in store for us. Not only in the world to come, but in this world. Andrew Womack preaches a sermon about the there. On the other side of there. Isn't that Andrew? Andrew Womack. I think Keith Moore has a sermon about that too. On the other side of there. On the other side of there is the provision. On the other side of there, when the Lord told Elijah to go to the brook Cherith, that's where his provision was there. And then when his provision dried up there, his provision was at the widow Zarephath. His provision is on the other side of obedience. The presence is on the other side of obedience. You know, God's promised us that he will inhabit the praises of his people. That's a promise. But he's saying, even that promise, I'll be there. I'll give you my presence. But what's better than that is for you to listen. And I really feel like the Lord is saying tonight, sermonette number one, is we need to practice the listening again. We need to practice the listening again. Because I know all of our hearts, both those in this room and many online, I know our hearts is for obedience. But we get so busy that we forget the listening. Be still and know that I am God. Listen. Pray, but listen. Shut up so you can hear. And then when you hear, then you can obey. And I think that's one thing the Lord is saying tonight. But it's like in all you're getting, we're going to have all that he's promised us. He's promised spirit of life and those in it. He's promised us his presence and his glory. We've obeyed everything that he's told us to do. And he said, if you do this and this and this, you will have my presence and my glory. We have done everything that he's told us. We have stayed there for 6 months with nothing else. Every time he's told us to go back to the glory and presence, we've gone back. Every time he said, go holy, we went holy. I mean, every single thing that he's told us, we've obeyed. So we already know we're going to have his presence and his glory. We already know that we're going to have healing. And we're going to have power. We're going to have miracles. We know that. But we have to, we want that. We have that heart for obedience. So when we hear, we definitely obey. But we need to get back to the hearing. And I think we just, you know, we get so busy that the Lord said this a month ago, he said this a week ago, so it's okay tonight, but what is he saying for tonight? You know, he told us 6 months ago to go into the frequencies. Is that what he's saying for tonight? You know, I think that there's times when we're supposed to go into, sometimes we are to do canned music. Is that okay? Yes, if the Lord said so, do it. You know, and I think that we were obedient tonight. We actually kind of did both. But what I'm saying, so I'm not saying anything about tonight. Understand that. What I'm saying is we need to be extra diligent to hear and obey. But hear first. Does that make sense? Okay. So now I'm going to be like Ron. Can I do the second one? Well, the other one, that one that was short. This one is interesting, and I think it kind of falls into place because it's actually, I mean, I've thought about it a lot because I quoted it a lot this last 3 weeks, but it's Elaine's favorite verse. And it's Psalm 16, and it says, verse 5, it says, O Lord, you are the portion of my inheritance and my cup. You maintain my lot. The lines have fallen to me in pleasant places. Yes, I have a good inheritance. I will bless the Lord who has given me counsel. My heart also instructs me in the night seasons. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. Therefore, my heart is glad and my glory rejoices, and my flesh also will rest in hope. You will not leave my soul in Sheol, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. And really, what I thought was interesting, like I said, I thought about a lot this week, but anyway, or this last few weeks, but in verse 5, it says, O Lord, you are my portion of my inheritance and my cup. You maintain my lot. There are four words in that scripture that talk about lot. And lot is your portion. Lot is, you know. And those four words are portion, inheritance, cup, and lot. And I thought it was interesting about these. And so I just want to touch on these really quick. I'll do it quick. But portion, that's actually the word manna. Okay? So portion is given by right. Oh, thanks. Yeah, I started coughing. Thanks. So your portion is because you have a right to it. And it says, the Lord is my portion. He's talking about the Lord is my portion. The Lord is my inheritance. So the Lord is my portion. Why is the Lord my portion? Why do I have a right to God? Why do I have a right for him? And in Psalms, I need to mark this. Because I'm going to kind of turn to, I'm going to just go through verses. Because the best way to know is through the scripture. Psalms 115, verse 16. They said, even the heavens are the Lord's, but the earth he has given to the children of men. Why do we have a right to our portion in the Lord? Because in Genesis, we all know Genesis 1:26, the Lord gave us create and complete authority, right? He gave us authority over everything that was created. But even more than that, in Genesis 2, it says in verse 7, then the Lord formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath or spirit of life, and man became a living being. See, so we have the right to God because he made us from this dirt. So we have the right to be earth. We have that right of the portion. But then Jesus, or God himself breathed into us. So now we have his breath. So we have the portion of God. We have that portion. Jesus, he said, the Lord is my portion. I have a right to God because he created me to have that right. You know, you're made from the earth and you're given to the earth by God. And he says, you're formed that way. Does that make sense? So it says, the Lord is my portion. It's my right, given by right. Do you understand what I'm saying? When it's given by right, nothing that you did, that's just your right. You have dominion over this earth. Why? Because you were born a man or a woman. You are born of the species of humankind. You have the right to dominion. Doesn't matter if you're a believer or not. Never said if you believe in the Lord. It says if you're born of a man or a woman, if you're born of a woman, you have right to have dominion over the earth. That's your right. That's your portion. Okay, then he says, Lord, you are my inheritance. You are my inheritance. The inheritance, the Lord is my inheritance, is given. Inheritance is given by birth. You see the difference? The right and the birth. Now, I thought it was interesting because this word also means smooth. Okay, you have inheritance because it's a smooth way to go. You know, how many times you think, oh, these rich kids got it because they were born into that family, right? It's smooth. It's not, okay? So given by birth, and why is that? We know that we're born into the kingdom of God. We're born into God's family. John 1, like I said, I want to just give you a few verses on each one of these. John 1, verse 12. It says, but to as many as receive and welcome him, he gave them the authority, the power, the privilege to become the children of God. That is to those who believe in his name. So if we believe in his name, we have the privilege to become the children of God. We have the privilege of being born into the family of God, right? And then Galatians 4, you guys know these scriptures. Electric Power and Gas Company. Somehow I'm messing up. Oh, Gas, Electric Power and Company. Gas comes first, isn't it? Okay. Galatians 4, verse 4. It says, but when the proper time had fully come. I always like it when you see that in the scriptures. When the proper time had fully come, it means, okay. Anyway, okay. So, but when the proper time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born subject to the regulation of the law, to purchase the freedom for those who are subject to the law, that we might be adopted and have sonship conferred upon us and be recognized as God's sons. And because you really are his sons, God has sent the Holy Spirit of his son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Therefore, verse 7, you are no longer a slave, but a servant. But a son. And if a servant, therefore you are no longer a slave, bondservant, but a son. And if a son, it follows that you are an heir by the aid of God through Christ. I kept seeing that bondservant in there. I had to say it. Okay. But we're no longer a slave. We're no longer a bondservant. We are an heir. We are born into the family. The Lord is our inheritance because we're born into the family. Okay, so not only do we have a right, but we have an inheritance in him. And, each one of these would preach. But each one of them is different. I thought it was interesting. Each one is a different way, different means of being a part of the Lord. Okay, and then it says in 16 verse 5, it says, O Lord, you are my portion of my inheritance and my cup. If you think of a cup, the Lord is our cup. Our cup is freely given. If you have a cup, it means it's freely, what's inside that container is freely given to you. Okay, it means that word cup actually means to hold together. It's a container. So I give Ann a cup. It's freely given to you. Okay, the Lord has freely given us all things. In Romans 8, verse 32, and he who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how will he not himself also freely give us all things? See, God, he freely gives us himself. So even says, the Lord is my cup. Psalm says that my cup runneth over. He freely gives us, and he gives us over and abundantly more than we could ever think or imagine. So the Lord is that cup that runs over. 2 Peter 1, it says, if I start quoting, I'll be in trouble. 2 Peter 1, verse 3. For his divine power has bestowed upon us all things that are requisite and suited for life and godliness through the full personal knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and excellence. By means of these, he bestowed on us his precious and exceedingly great promises. So the Lord has, he's our cup. He's freely given us himself. So the Lord has given himself to us by right of the fact that he created us from the dust to the ground. He's given us himself by the right of our inheritance because we were born. The Lord, by his graciousness, allowed us to be born into the family of God. He has freely given us of himself because he's our cup, the cup that overflows. But then he says, this one is different because in verse 5 it says, you, talking about the Lord, you maintain my lot. Okay? That word lot actually means rough. So just where inheritance means smooth, the word lot means rough. And both of those were used in relation to stones where they cast their lots. So some lots that they cast were smooth and some lots that they cast were rough. But this one means this lot, this rough, was given by chance, by choice. So this lot, it says, this one is not the Lord is. It says the Lord maintains this lot. The Lord maintains this choice. By choice, the Lord has given himself to us, and he maintains it. He takes control. He sustains it. He holds it fast. It says he follows close with it. So though he freely has given us of himself by right, and he's freely given us himself by choice, by birth, and he's freely given himself the cup, but he holds fast and he maintains our choice. See, in Deuteronomy, we all know this verse, in Deuteronomy 30, verse 19, where it says, in 19, I call heaven and earth to witness this day before you, that I have set before you life and death, blessings and cursings. Therefore, choose life, that you and your descendants may live. See, this choice, this lot, is what he places before us. And what we choose, he holds fast to it. He never forces us to choose him. In fact, he will fight for our choice to refuse him. But he also fights for our choice when we accept him. Joshua 24, you guys know this, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. When our family makes that choice, the Lord will fight for our family. You know, we're in this time right now in America where it's kind of upside down. And people are saying things and doing things that are idiotic and against what the Republic is about. But why do they have the right to do what they do, unless it's violence and all that stuff? Why do they have the right to speak? Because it's their choice. And because our forefathers have said, you know, that we have the right to freedom of choice, freedom of speech. And if we take away that, you know, it's like a lot of people say, well, we need to take away the rights of the Muslim or the Buddhist or whatever. But if we take away their right for choice, they start to take away our right. And that's what I'm saying. The Lord will fight for their right to choose, as much as he'll fight for our right to choose him. He says, I'll set before you life and death. But have you ever thought that the Lord fights for your right to choose death? If you want to, he is not going to. We can pray every witchcraft prayer we want to try and get our kids saved. But the Lord will say, I will not manipulate them. I give them a choice. And when we pray for them, and when we believe for them, he will give them time and time again to make that choice. Every time we pray, he will give them that time to make that choice. But he will never manipulate them into making that choice. And that's what, you know, he maintains that. So it's like, here are these things that talk about the lot that we have, the choices that we make, the things that we are portioned. But this portion of choice, the Lord will fight for it. And how much are we grateful for the choice, the opportunity to have the choice to serve him? I mean, every person in this room understands, and if we'll go back to what America is doing right, or what the world is doing right now, we understand God's side of it. We understand the light versus the dark. But do you realize the opportunity that we've had to hear the truth? When it comes to the promises of God, do we understand and are we grateful for the opportunity to have that choice? Some people won't get the choice until they die. I remember the time, I don't know if I'll ever forget all my whole life. I was with my dad in the marketplace when we were in Dipongo. And I remember, of course, this happened a lot, but this particular time is the one I remember often, is we were in the marketplace and this guy came up that I did not recognize, and he asked my dad, are you the missionary? My dad said, yes. And he says, you need to come with me over the mountain. And my dad was one that questioned. He goes, well, why? He says, my people have never heard the name of Jesus. And I had to listen to my dad say, I can't go. There was only one of me, and I can't go. But you've heard the name of Jesus, you go. Now, how many times have we had the choice to hear the name of Jesus? And there are people that have never heard the name of Jesus. They've never had the choice that we've had. You know, how we're sitting here and everyone here believes in the prophetic word. How many people love the Lord with everything within them and they're sitting in a church that they've never had the opportunity to have a prophetic word? Are we grateful for the choices that the Lord has given us? And do we fight for those choices like the Lord fights over us? The Lord is my portion. The Lord is my inheritance. The Lord is my cup. But he's also my choice. And am I willing to fight for that choice as much as he's willing to fight for me? And I think about that. I'm like, I can look at that surface and say, look what the Lord is to me. Or I can say, look at the opportunity. Look at the blessing that I'm grateful for. Because the next verse says, the lions have fallen for me in pleasant places. That actually means the rope, a measuring line. It means that inheritance. Okay, do you know, or have you thought, in looking at land, the Lord doesn't, there's all kinds of land. That land can be desert land. It can be pasture land. It can be trees. There's all different kinds of land. And the Lord said, and the scripture says, the lions have fallen for me. My inheritance has fallen in a pleasant, a delightful place. That means it's not a bunch of scrub brush. Why do we expect our inheritance to be the desert, the Sahara Desert, where nothing blows but wind? Why we're saying, the Lord says, if we choose the Lord, if he is my inheritance, if he is my portion, this is all good and perfect gifts come from the Father. There's no shadow of turning. That means the Lord only gives good gifts. So our inheritance, we should be looking for the good. We don't need to be looking for the half-baked. We need to be looking for the good, the pleasant places. And then it says, yes, I have a good inheritance. That word inheritance there means heritage. It means estate. It means patrimony. It means that my forefathers have prepared a good estate for me to take over. And it might not be the earthly parents, but how many of the heavenly saints have gone before us and prepared where we're at now? That's our heritage. That's our estate. And we've heard stories and we've seen it, you know, where a person can inherit a really good estate, and within a generation, it's in ruins. What are we going to do with the estate that we inherit? Are we going to esteem it and we're going to follow after what they're doing and improve upon it? Or are we going to say, they've done it, let's just sit back and rest on their laurels? Because it'll go to pot real quick, right? So these just two verses that I really wanted to focus on, because it's both. The Lord has given himself, but we have responsibility. He's given us an inheritance, but we need to esteem it and we need to grow it. And this is just for fun. But the next verse, I'm not going to go into it. But the next verse says, I will bless the Lord who has given me counsel, right? My heart also instructs me in the night season. So it says, you know, the Lord will give me counsel. He'll teach us how to maintain that inheritance. He'll teach us how to increase. He'll teach us what our right is, what our, you know, birth, our inheritance is. But it says, my heart, that word actually means kidney. My kidney, you know, it's like Mark Lowry's verse, you know, make my liver quiver, make my, anyway. Okay, so it's that word kidney. It's the inner part. It's that mind. It's the thing that goes, instructs me. And that instruct actually means chastises me in the night season. Because I have set the Lord before me always, I won't be moved. So the Lord will counsel me. But my innermost kidneys will chastise me if I buck what the Lord wants to do. I guess it goes back to the bridle. In all of our ways, we get understanding. The Lord instructs us. But my innermost being, my kidneys, my filter says, I'm going to obey. I'm going to set the Lord before me at all times so that he will be my portion. He will be my inheritance. He will be my cup. And he will be my lot. And as the Lord fights for me, I will fight for him. And I will be grateful for all that he has put before us. And I will endeavor to always have a hearing ear and a listening heart. Amen? Amen. Amen. Do you want this?
Good word.
Thank you, Debbie. Good word tonight. Obedience is not an easy thing, but it's the principal thing. It's the main thing. Amen. To obey is better than sacrifice. I think we would at times we would live our own rebellious life, and then when it comes to church, we want to give $1,000 to somehow make up for our bad attitude. God's like, no, not happening. It's the heart. God focuses on the heart. The Bible says man looks on the outside, but God looks at the heart. And God judges us according to our heart. Saul, that everybody thought Saul was the deal, but God said, I've rejected him. But then he said, I have found little David, a man after my own heart. He was up on the hillside under a tree playing hymns and songs on his little harp to God and telling God how much he loved him. And God saw an up-and-comer who would follow him. And the one thing about David, even though he had fell away from the Lord with Bathsheba, when he was confronted with it, he said, oh God, forgive me. And he was quick to repent. And although he had to face the music, yet God did not turn from him. He said, do not take away from me your Holy Spirit. And God said, he's a man after my own heart. And Solomon, God did things for Solomon out of respect for his covenant for David. Because God had such a love, and God had established that love between him and David, that even in a later generation, he did things out of respect for that covenant that he had made with David. And it goes back to our heart. It's all about the heart. It's not about what we can bring to the Lord monetarily or what we can build him. He doesn't want kingdoms. He wants obedience. When he says, go out there and do it, that's what he wants us to do. Go out there and do it. And that is our sacrifice. He says, I don't want this. When I tell you to do this, this is what I want. I want you to obey what I have spoken to you. I don't want you to give large in the offering because you can't mind. You know, if you have a child and you tell him to do something and he is rebellious and he will not do it, and then later on, all of a sudden, now he wants to give mom and dad this, what's he trying to do? The very same thing we try to work with God. We're trying to give the offering to offset our evil heart. God says, let's check the heart. If the heart's right, everything else falls in place. Cain and Abel. God had told Abel, I want the lamb. Abel said, here's the lamb. God said, I accept it. Cain, on the other hand, said, how about some vegetables? They came out of my, they're the best. And when God didn't receive it, he got angry. And he says, if you do what's right, you'll be received. But you've got to, when I tell you something, you can't bring your program to God. When he says, here's what I want, that's what he wants. Now it's up to us. He told Cain, he said, and I want to warn you, sin is at your door, which is basically saying, buddy, like you tell your daughter or your son, buddy, you're getting awful close to walking on that line, and it's fixing to happen. And yet, what did he do? He went on. And he didn't esteem the rebuke of the Lord. God wants obedience. God wants obedience. And if we can get that, and we can understand that, we don't have to be jerked around by our bridle. The other way of turning a horse, I believe, is called reining. And that's where you take, instead of jerking the horse to the left or right, that's where when the reins fall against the horse's neck and you lean it and he feels that gentle push of the rein on his neck, he understands master wants to go to the left and he'll go left, and then he feels the other one going this way. And I think it's also with the foot, with your knee, but basically it's a lot of things. Yes. Yeah, but it's the subtleties of the communication between the rider and the horse. It's not like I have to jerk the slack out of you to get you to do anything. It's that there's that understanding. There's hours in the saddle, so to speak, and the where you've been taught to either by the rein or by the leaning and the weight or whatever it may be, to the horse starts to understand what the master wants to do, and then it's not a fight. It can be, like you say, it can be a dance where one is leading, the other is following, and it's a beautiful thing. And that's what God wants with us. He wants us to be obedient. When we feel his gentle, we don't ignore that. We say, oh, the Holy Spirit wants to take a left. Let's go left. Oh, he said stop. I don't understand it, but he's in the saddle, not me. So I'm going to stop. And so God leads us gently. And we respond gently, don't we? Everybody nod. Yes. Yes, I do what God tells me. And it's an open book test when he says, choose death or life. And then he says, heads up. Life is better. Choose life that you may live, that you and your family and your children may live. He wants what's best for us, but he instructs us. This is the way to go. When I tell you to go this way, gently, just do it. You may not understand it, but if you'll do it, it will be well with you. Amen? Amen. Well, let's give our offering this evening, and amen.
Plan. to move on into the promised land. Joshua was a man, the Lord gave a plan to move on into the promised land. He crossed over the river Jordan, God delivered the enemy into his hands. As the trumpet sound, it'll shake the ground as the children of God march round and round. So they march 7 times around the city. Jail, they didn't cry, weep or wail. Paul and Silas were sent to jail, they didn't cry, weep or wail. They began to sing in the midst of their song. The whole earth shook, and it didn't take long. The prison doors, they couldn't stay shut.
Before we pray, I'd like to give a quick testimony. Over the last couple days, with the passing of our dear Elaine, we had some unexpected expenses that came up quite suddenly and some demands that were immediate, and we had the opportunity to face them. So, that being said, yes, funeral expenses. Anyway, we trusted the Lord and just said, Lord, you're with us. You knew this surprised us, but it didn't surprise you. And so, I don't know if you'd heard, but we lost one of our board members on Saturday morning. She had a stroke a couple weeks ago. And so, anyway, we had the memorial service yesterday. But there's just been a lot of expenses and things that we had to deal with. But we prayed and we asked the Lord. We said, we know, Lord, this surprised us, but it did not surprise you. So we continued to go forward. When we had the service yesterday, the memorial service, the money that came in from people just saying, here, put this in the offering. Let me help. More than covered the expenses that surprised us. So we now are blessed. But I would just like to say thank you, Lord, because He knows what we're up against. There's a verse in Job that really gets me. And Job told his friends, he said, He knows the way that I take, and when I am tried, I will come forth as pure gold. And a lot of times when I don't know the way, I say, He knows the way that I take, and when I'm tried, I will come forth as gold, pure gold. So I just like to say thank you, Lord, for the blessings. Thank you, Lord, for being faithful. And testify that God is good and He has met all of our needs, and good things are yet to come. Amen. Father, we thank You for all Your blessings. We thank You for Your grace. We thank You that we can count on You when we don't know, Father, what is around the corner. You are aware of all that is coming up. You see, Father God, the end from the beginning, and nothing surprises You. Father God, You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Father God, our lines have fallen for us in pleasant places. And Father God, we have a goodly inheritance. So Father God, we thank You for what has been given this evening. We pray, Father God, that as Your word says, given it shall be given unto you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall be given into your bosom. Father God, we say in Jesus' name that we believe that as people have given, Father God, it shall be given back to them. You are the Lord of the harvest, and You will cause great things to happen in our life. We believe for healing. We believe for miracles. We believe in faith for great and mighty things to happen in our life. And in Jesus' name, Father God, we look to their fulfillment. We say all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. So we will see you. We meet again Thursday night at 7 o'clock. We will see you then. You are dismissed. Amen.